This is David Clough. David comes to us from the University of Chester, where he is professor of theological ethics, which he describes as the ethical questions provoked by the juxtaposition of the Christian tradition and the world as we find it. He is also a Methodist local preacher, active in UK Methodist and National Ecumenical Working Groups on Ethics. David's early work specifically addressed human animals like Karl Barth and the ethics, the human ethics of war and peace. Then he expanded his view with articles such as What's the Point of Animals? And Not a Not Animal, the Vocation to Be a Human Animal Creature, with edited volumes such as Creaturely Theology on God, Humans, and Other Animals, co-edited with Celia Dean Drummond. Most recently, David has been working on a two-volume project, the first, On Animals, Systematic Theology, published in 2012, and On Animals, Theological Ethics, coming out next year. The first volume has been enthusiastically received, cited as indisputably the most important and comprehensive theological treatment of animals to have appeared in any language at any time in the Christian tradition. And again, it lays to rest so many of the false problematics that previously characterized the Christian tradition of thinking about animals. David's inaugural lecture at Chester, Rethinking Animality Towards a New Animal Ethics, was presented with two animals on the stage, a chicken and David. The video is posted on Chester's website, and you can watch it to see the chicken upstage the lecturer. Without a chicken, David will now speak to us on Mirroring Narcissus, the Pursuit of Human Uniqueness as Species-Level Narcissism.
I'm grateful for that introduction, Margaret. I'm very grateful to the conference organizers for the invitation. As I finished drafting this paper, I realized that I hadn't previously given a conference paper that suggests the conference topic was ill-advised and the academics gathered to discuss it should find something better to do. So I'm particularly grateful for you for coming this morning, and I'll understand if I have no one to talk to over coffee. I want to begin this paper by discussing what makes me different from everyone else. You might initially think that I am very similar to other humans. It is true that I have the same number of legs and arms, fingers and toes as most other humans, a typical arrangement of internal organs to the best of my knowledge, and am of average height and weight for a male of my race and geographical location. I'm able to make advanced use of tools, like most other humans, and like other humans, live within a complex system of social ordering and economic exchange that allows me to specialize in the development of particular skills. Like many other humans, I live in a small domestic family unit with a partner and children. So what is it beyond these typical attributes that make me different? Well, we could start with my particular profession. In various roles, I've spent the majority of my life working in university institutions, which means, like most of you, I'm numbered among the very small group of humans that would describe themselves as academics. We can agree, I am sure, that one of the typical features of academics is an intelligence well above the species average, as well as related skills in the rapid assimilation of textual information and the ability to manipulate knowledge in innovative ways. In distinction from many among this multidisciplinary academic company, my academic specialism is Christian theology, so I'm one of perhaps a few hundred professors with recognized expertise in this field. Among them, very few show any developed professional interest in researching the place of non-human animals in Christian texts and doctrine, and the ethical questions this presents us with. So this field of peers numbers me among perhaps just a handful. Of those, I am confident that I'm the only one that can program web database interfaces in PHP and MySQL coding languages, play the guitar, find my way up and down mountains, cycle from Anglesey to Chester, dissemble and reassemble a concrete garage, cook a mean vegan paella. I could go on, but I think we can all agree that this particular collection of capacities and skills makes me different from everyone else. I hope this opening to my paper has not made you feel uncomfortable. I appreciate that what makes me unique is not a common topic of academic papers in theology or any other discipline. Perhaps you find it hard to appreciate the importance of what makes me different, or its relevance to wider academic inquiry. Perhaps you think my interest in this question is at least unseemly, or at worst betrays the moral failing of being too preoccupied with oneself, which might make me inattentive to the well-being of others or to the wider world. Or perhaps you think that my seeking to identify the difference between me and everyone else is motivated by a concern to increase my status relative to others, and thereby gain social or economic advantage. Whichever is the case, you are probably wishing I would stop reflecting on my own uniqueness and start giving an academic analysis relevant to the topic of our conference. There is, of course, a classical locus for being overly preoccupied with the self. Ovid recounts the tale of Narcissus in book 3 of his Metamorphoses. The beautiful youth, desired by men and women alike, but proud and disdainful of all, until out hunting he caught sight of his own image in a clear pool of shimmering water. He was instantly captivated and worshipped in self-adoration, wrapped with desire for himself. Yet every time he leaned forward to kiss this beautiful image, encouraged by the reciprocal movement of the image on the other side of the water's surface, the pool betrayed him. He plunged in his arms to clasp the ivory neck of the image and finds himself clutching at no one. Unable to tear himself away from his image, yet unable to grasp his love, he faded away and melted, slowly consumed by the fire inside him. Caravaggio's painting captures Narcissus's experience. For Narcissus, nothing exists beyond himself and the image. From a theological point of view, it is Ovid's characterization of Narcissus worshipping in self-adoration that is most striking. Narcissus is not merely guilty of self-obsession, but of idolatry, worshipping himself in place of God. For the Christian theologian Augustine of Hippo, writing in the early 5th century, Narcissus' sin is that of a disordered love, failing to recognize that the ultimate and unchangeable good of God is far superior to oneself, and so should be our priority in loving. The implications of such a mistake are not merely individual. For Augustine, it is disordered self-love that led to the doomed Roman imperial project that sought human glory through the building of an earthly city, rather than seeking after the glory of God. It seems then that beginning this paper with an attempt to delineate the difference between me and every other person was a mistake for at least 3 reasons. First, because reflecting on my own uniqueness is an unprofitable use of my time and yours. It's unclear what would be achieved by it. Narcissus gains nothing by his self-contemplation. Second, pondering on the difference between me and others manifests a drastically limited vision. By choosing to look like Narcissus only at my own reflected image, I'm also choosing not to attend to the beauty and need of others in the world. So I will miss other objects of love that will leave my life impoverished, aesthetically and morally. Third, whereas the motive of Narcissus was simple self-love, we should be anxious that my motive is more complex, manipulative, and socially dangerous. Those who trumpet their own distinctive merits are often seeking an increase in their social status, and therefore a reduction in the status of others. But this, you will be glad to hear, is not a paper about me. It is a paper about us. This immediate us, as academics concerned with the question of what differentiates humans from other animals, and a broader us, the human species. Your discomfort at the narcissism of my individual project of specifying the features that make me distinct from other humans is my discomfort at our collective project of specifying the features that make humans distinct from other animals. The unseemly scene you have just witnessed of me narcissistically attempting to specify what makes me unique is routine in academic and popular literature at the level of human species, and I suggest no less narcissistic. If Merlin was right yesterday to say that narcissism has gone viral, I want to suggest that narcissism has gone collective. We are, as a species, like Narcissus, captivated by our own image and unable to turn our gaze away. It seems that no question is more interesting to us than what makes human beings different from other animals. We love to gaze into the mirror pool, repeating to ourselves the familiar and consoling story that, unlike all other animals, we are special, unique, different, and superior. Just as Ovid's story makes clear that individual narcissism is no modern innovation, so we should recognize that our predilection for species-level narcissism has long roots. The idea that human beings were the only animals with understanding seems to have been a commonplace of Greek thought by the time of Aristotle in the 4th century BC. And there are no shortage of additional features supposed to be unique to human beings. Religiosity, Plato, justice, Hesiod, hair, Aristotle, an appreciation of smells beyond that required for food, Aristotle, spirituality and the use of fire, Lactantius, divinity or its image, Plato, among many others, the possession of ears that cannot be moved, Aristotle, the capacity to look up to the heavens rather than looking down at the earth like the beasts, Minucius Felix, among others, the proclivity to do willful hurt to each other, Hobbes, the universal production of goods, Marx, the ability to promise and assess value, exercise conscience and self-control, and display arrogance and vanity, Nietzsche, the capacity to form the world, Heidegger, the possession of avarice, miserliness, cruelty, and the ability to blush and need to, Mark Twain, language, Noam Chomsky, symbol-making, Richard Leakey. This long but partial list may be a reassurance to us in that a preoccupation with characteristics of the human is clearly not merely a modern development. But the list ought also to be a caution in that it is clear that non-human animals manifest many of the characteristics previously thought to be unique to human beings. Given this impressively long genealogy of attempts to specify human difference, I recognize that I have a task ahead in order to convince you that this tradition of thought has led us to being trapped by Narcissus's pool. Why, then, is the attempt to specify human difference problematically narcissistic on my account? Fundamentally, I suggest, for analogous reasons that individual narcissism is problematic. Let us review, then, the reasons I offered for thinking that an individual being preoccupied with their difference, in this case me, might be problematic. First, I suggested that devoting time to consider the ways in which I am different from other individuals was an unfruitful waste of time. Spending time on species-level differences, I suggest, is similarly unfruitful. We must ask, what is the use of the knowledge we seek to gain from delineating human difference? We might be able to give an answer to this in particular contexts. For evolutionary anthropology, attending to when particular human characteristics appeared in our evolutionary history is an important enterprise, though studies of this kind are very likely to make us realize that the boundaries of the human are fuzzy rather than well-formed, and some human-like characteristics have evolved in other species through a different evolutionary path. For medical researchers seeking to draw conclusions about human health on the basis of experimental data relating to non-human animals, it will be important to be aware of the differences between human physiology and the physiology of other animal species. But this is attention to particular differences, rather than attempting to specify a human non-human boundary. There is every reason in any number of areas of inquiry to be attentive to the particularity of what it means to be human. But this is by no means the same project of delineating difference between humans and all other animals. Many of the ways we attend to particularity are through a recognition of circles of commonality. What is the creature I see alongside me as I cycle? It is an animal, a bird, a finch, flashing yellow and black as it flies almost like a bee. Ah yes, it's a goldfinch, identifiable as the intersection of circles of commonality, rather than an attempt to delineate all the attributes that make it unique. Human distinctiveness is very often used as a rhetorical device, which Robert Renahan has argued is characteristic of Greek thought and those influenced by it. Once you start looking out for examples where arguments are made on the basis of humans are the only animal that can X, or X is a uniquely human characteristic, therefore, you see it everywhere. A quick search of recent newspaper articles produced a psychologist providing a rationale for dieting based on the claim that humans are the only animals that use food to feast. An article on the benefits of crying, using the claim that only humans cry emotional tears. An explanation for why men go to sleep after sex, suggesting that humans are the only animals in which sleep and sex are linked. A reflection on middle age, suggesting that humans are the only animals that have it, and a guide to the neuroeconomics of decision-making, claiming that humans are the only animals that can delay gratification. I could go on. It's notable that all of these articles were citing academics for the claims about human uniqueness, though not academics with expertise in any kind of animal studies. Most of these claims are false, but even if they were true, it is not clear what their truth would add to any argument. If it were true, for example, as it may be, that human beings are the only species to throw long pointed sticks at targets, would that mean that the javelin is a more laudable Olympic sport than sprinting, in which other animals also participate? The interest we clearly have in appeals to human uniqueness seems to have no obvious logic. The fact that human beings have a particular capacity for function in a particular way is interesting in itself, whether or not other animals share such capacities or functions. The discovery that terrestrial or extraterrestrial life shared one or more of our abilities that we had previously thought unique changes absolutely nothing relevant to our own exercise of our own abilities. There seems nothing gained here in identifying human distinctiveness. So the first reason I suggested that individual narcissism is problematic is because it's unfruitful. The second reason I suggested that my reflection on what makes me unique was a mistake was that such narcissism drastically limited my vision. The same is the case with a preoccupation with human distinctiveness. As the newspaper examples I just noted make clear, many of our claims about human difference are made without detailed knowledge of non-human animal lives. Any passing familiarity with behavioral studies of other animals, for example, would make clear that very many non-human species are capable of delayed gratification for a greater reward, including young chickens. When the appeal to human difference is rhetorical, there is little interest in the accuracy of the claim. We can continue gazing with Narcissus at our own reflection without noticing the other animals we live alongside who would undermine our sense of distinctiveness. Even when we do seriously attend to the capacities of non-human animals, if we are preoccupied with the question of human difference, we are likely only to be interested in them insofar as they compare to the human capacities we value. Experiments studying the intelligence of other animals, therefore, regularly make headlines, such as the experiment to which Nancy referred yesterday of chimpanzees in a Japanese primate research facility, some of whom were able to recall numerical digits in order faster than human research subjects. For chimpanzees to learn human mathematical symbols and retain them in order is remarkable. But this experiment very clearly tests their ability to do well at a human test rather than attend to the ways in which they operate within their own environment, as Nancy noted. Similar studies showing that parrots can use abstract characteristics such as shape and color, or that dolphins can pass grammar, similarly measure non-human ability against human criteria. One wonders what new understanding we would attain concerning the lives of other animals if we were able to escape our concern with human non-human differentiation and attend to the lives of other animals more frequently in their own right. We should note here in passing that we are much more interested in building species hierarchies focused on capacities that place humans at the top than with hierarchies based on other measures. We could choose to order animals by size or weight, say from blue whales to nematodes, by individual longevity, giant tortoises to mayflies, perhaps, by species age, the Lingulia brachiopod to, for example, a species of the genus Cyprinodon in Lake Chichinaba, by speed, peregrine falcon to sloth or snail, by loudness, tiger pistol shrimp to any number of silent animals, by color, red pandas to sparkling violet ear hummingbirds, number of legs, millipedes to snakes, and so on and so on. There are many, many hierarchies according to which the place of humans is inconsequential. In addition to the concerns that a narcissistic preoccupation with individual differentiation was unfruitful and secondly narrow in vision, the third reason I gave above for judging it mistaken was that a concern to demarcate difference could be socially dangerous status seeking. At the species level, this is my greatest concern. The potential for the pursuit of the question of human distinctiveness to be dangerous, both for humans and for other animals. First, in relation to humans, we might initially think it useful to have a reliable test of whether a particular individual before us is human. But the history of such efforts shows it to be a very dangerous enterprise. For the Plato of the Timaeus, it is the immortal male soul that is the measure of all, and women are classified with non-human animals as morally defective. His pupil Aristotle justified war to force those intended by nature to be slaves to submit. For European colonizers in the 16th century and onwards, part of the justification for the conquest and displacement of native peoples that they encountered was their subhumanity, judged by their difference from the colonizers' modes of life. For the slave owners in the 19th century United States, the same logic justified the institution of slavery. For the Nazi regime in 1930s Germany, Jews, Roma, Slavs, black people, homosexuals, and the disabled were classified as Untermensch, legitimizing their extermination. Genocidal massacres elsewhere are very frequently associated with the dehumanization of their victims. In The Open, Giorgio Agamben sees these outcomes as the inevitable product of the anthropological machine. Wherever we seek to differentiate systematically between human and non-human, Agamben says we create a zone of exception, of marginal groups with no rights, just bare life. It is not difficult to see how this happens. As soon as we pick on a marker to identify the human, some people look more human than others. If sophisticated cognitive ability is picked as the characteristically human trait, for example, then people like us, who pride themselves on high-level reasoning skills, are the most human of all, and those with severe learning difficulties or dementia are the least human. Is it not a red flag that scholars have tended to pick measures of humanity according to which they themselves excel in comparison to most humans? The project of constructing human difference is therefore inherently political, dangerously identifying some humans as less human than other humans. One particular group of human beings that are likely to be disadvantaged by our attempt to specify the human difference are persons with learning disabilities. If we focus, as we have done frequently in this conference, on cognitive criteria to characterize the uniqueness of the human, those humans with limited cognitive capacity are in danger of being rendered less human. Proponents of cognitive criteria may protest that this is not their intention, and I believe them. It is, however, the inevitable outcome of any attempt to set up a humanness test, including a cognitive component. If we set the criteria high enough to ensure that only humans satisfy the test, for example, requiring the ability to write a novel or prove a mathematical theorem according to accepted conventions of logical argument, we can be confident that no non-human animal will be able to meet it. But it is also clear that many humans will also fall outside the humanness magic circle. If we set the criterion low enough to ensure that most humans satisfy the test, for example, a self-conscious being with preferences about the future, we can be confident both that some humans will still fall outside this magic circle and that some non-human animals will fall inside it. Defenders of such accounts of the human difference might seek to avoid the appalling conclusion that those with learning disabilities are subhuman by saying that these are tests just seeking to identify species-typical characteristics. But this cannot escape the conclusion that we have made a decision about what it means to be human, and some would-be humans fall short and are admissible only as exceptions. If the impact of human preoccupation with establishing our distinctiveness seems dangerous in relation to human beings, it is even more dangerous for those animals classified as non-human. Once we have erected a high wall between human beings and other kinds of animals, on the basis of our supposed human difference, the animals beyond the wall are vulnerable to being exploited for their economic utility to human beings almost without limit. It is the binary logic of the human-non-human animal difference that erases all difference between non-human animals. Jacques Derrida put it best, quote, "Confined within this catch-all concept, within this vast encampment of the animal, in this general singular, within the strict enclosure of this definite article, the animal and not animals, as in a virgin forest, a zoo, a hunting or fishing ground, a paddock or an abattoir, a space of domestication, are all the living things that man does not recognize as his fellows, his neighbors, or his brothers. And that is so in spite of the infinite space that separates the lizard from the dog, the protozoan from the dolphin, the shark from the lamb, the parrot from the chimpanzee, the camel from the eagle, the squirrel from the tiger, or the elephant from the cat, the ant from the silkworm, or the hedgehog from the echidna. I interrupt my nomenclature and call Noah to help ensure that no one gets left on the ark. Unquote. Once we've determined that another animal belongs on the far side of the human-non-human divide, they are even more vulnerable than the human situation of bare life diagnosed by a gamben. A chimpanzee sharing so much in common with us, as we have heard, in terms of dependence on social structures and relationships and an inquisitive desire to explore and manipulate her environment, can have her complex and socially sophisticated existence placed entirely in the hands of the human who is given property rights over her and can therefore choose to keep her in solitary confinement in a small cage, can in many jurisdictions subject her to painful research experimentation without her consent, and as Anna reminded us, can determine when she should be killed. Let me introduce you to one of my nearest neighbours in Chester, called Boris. Boris was born in 1966, which means he's 2 years older than me. This photo was taken in 2011. Boris was born in Sierra Leone in 1966, captured from the wild and bought by a rundown pet shop called Treflix in New York. He was kept there in a kitten carrying case until he was sold at a few months old for $1,000 to a New York socialite and writer, Hester Mundis. Boris lived with the family until 1969, when Hester became pregnant with her second child and decided that a baby and a chimpanzee were not compatible in a New York apartment. She looked for a home for Boris and decided that Chester Zoo could provide the best environment for him. So since 1969 until today, Boris has lived in the chimpanzee enclosure at Chester, a couple of hundred meters from my home. He spent some time as leader of the troop of chimpanzees at Chester, though has since been succeeded by Dylan, a younger male. When I make the short trip to visit the chimpanzee enclosure at the zoo, I am constantly struck by our parallel biographies, leading to our meeting either side of the transparent window of his enclosure. Like me, Boris is a primate with a history, a biography, and a personality. A list of the differences between humans and other animals would miss a very great deal of what is most fundamental about the particular and individual chimpanzee and human that we are. To lump Boris with every other chimpanzee, let alone every other animal, would clearly miss many aspects of the individual that he is, let alone to categorize him with every other individual of every other kind of non-human animal in Derrida's vast encampment. Barbara's fieldwork with gorillas and baboons, about which we'll hear more later today, and among numerous other primate studies, show that it's inescapable to recognize his differences between the behavior of particular apes, particular individual apes. Other research is confirming that many other species, such as songbirds, exhibit behavioral differences between individuals that make generalization at species level highly problematic. Once we begin to take seriously the individuality of particular non-human animals, as well as particular humans, the project of trying to identify the difference, between all humans and all non-humans seems almost as absurd as the system of animal classification George Louis Bourges claims to have discovered in an ancient Chinese encyclopedia. I couldn't resist bringing this to you this morning. So Bourges writes, on those remote pages, it is written that animals are divided into A, those that belong to the emperor, B, embalmed ones, C, those that are trained, D, suckling pigs, E, mermaids, F, fabulous ones, G, stray dogs, H, this is my favorite, those that are included in this classification, I, those that tremble as if they were mad. J, innumerable ones. K, those drawn with a very fine camel's hair brush. L, others. M, those who have just broken a flower vase. N, those that resemble flies from a distance. At an individual level, we quickly recognize that a preoccupation with narrating the difference between oneself and others can often be motivated by status seeking, with consequent costs for the relative status of others. At a species level, the same dynamics are at play. If we can convince ourselves of the significance of a select group of characteristics that are supposedly uniquely human possessions, we can rationalize our self-attribution of moral status to human animals and our denial of moral status to other animals. This is very convenient. It gives us permission to reshape the lives of farmed animals and reshape the animals themselves to produce human food at ever cheaper costs. Red jungle fowl have been selectively bred for egg production, such that their productivity increases from 10 to 15 eggs per year in the wild to more than 300 eggs per year in the intensive windowless caged production facilities in which virtually all of them are now housed, with their productive laying life reduced to only 18 months. The male chicks from those laying strains are economically useless, so killed at a day old as soon as they've been sexed, often by being dropped live into the blades of a macerator. Other strains of hens have been selectively bred to be raised in huge broiler facilities, reaching slaughter weight in as little as 35 days, though many are now suffering from the inability of their legs to support their newly hefty bodies. At one broiler shed I visited, I held a hen that was 16 days old, just beginning to grow its mature feathers halfway through its life, surrounded an enormous shed by 24,000 other hens the same age, with other similar sheds nearby bringing the total to 600,000. They'd all been delivered to that site as day-old chicks and would all be grabbed by the legs and forced into crates, driven down the motorway for 2 hours to the slaughterhouse, there to be turned upside down, have their feet fixed to the chains of a conveyor, and be taken through an electric water bath supposed to stun, but which has been shown often to be ineffective, before having their throats mechanically cut and bleeding to death as they're defeathered and dismembered. Such systems of production treat live animals as mere crops or industrial raw material. They are justifiable only on the basis of the human difference, which equates here to the difference that human lives matter and non-human lives do not. Our preoccupation with the human difference funds and fuels this systematic disregard of non-human animal lives. We must add the broiler sheds and the other sites of industrial agriculture to the outputs of a Agamben's anthropological machine. The animals that find themselves the wrong side of this supposedly ultimate difference are thereby judged unprotected and condemned to be exploited in whatever ways we find convenient. Up to this point, I've argued that our preoccupation with the human difference is the practice of communal narcissism, and is problematic because first, it's fruitless, second, it distorts our vision of the non-human world, and third, it is dangerous, both for humans rendered marginal by the criteria for humanity we suggest, and for the non-humans left outside the magic circle of the human. In the final section of my paper, I want to make one clarification, offer one suggestion for a mode of inquiry that is a preferable alternative to the quest for the human difference, and add a final theological footnote. First, then, a clarification. It's important to note that in challenging the quest to find the right criteria to construct an unequivocal boundary between humans and other animals, like Nancy, I am not saying there are no differences between humans and other animals. Of course, there are myriad points of physiological and behavioral difference we could detail between humans and any other animal species with which we might care to compare ourselves. Humans are clearly non-identical with chimpanzees or gorillas or dolphins or rabbits or worms. I am not making a case for the sameness of humans and other animals. Human beings are unique, just like every other species of animal. The project of specifying human difference is not unsuccessful because there are no differences between humans and other kinds of animal, but because there are too many and various and complex differences, and they are different in relation to each other species of animal. There is nothing whatever that is problematic in noting the very many ways that human and chimpanzee individuals differ. What is problematic is when we seek to go beyond all these particular differences in order to attain a master, singular, and simple difference that transcends all particularities. In relation to our conference title, The Human Difference, the definite article at the beginning, the lack of a plural at the end, and the absence of any comparator all point to the problematic supposed singular difference element. What is the difference between a duck? Again, comes to mind. In further clarification, I'm also not signing up with George Orwell and Peter Singer's ethical slogan that all animals are equal. I believe that we have moral duties towards other human beings that are more stringent than those we have towards other animals. I do not believe, however, that these can be clearly grounded on a singular, morally significant characteristic difference between humans and other animals. It is, in fact, very rare that we face dilemmas in which human and non-human well-being are opposed. But where we do, such as in the philosophical favorite of a human baby and a non-human animal drowning in circumstances that mean we can only save one, we should choose the human. I would justify this choice on a similar basis to one that would lead me to show preference to members of my own family. We could add other reasons, theological and otherwise. It does not seem to me, however, that such a justification depends on any univocal account of human difference. While it is the case that all animals are different then, it is not the case that pursuing the human difference is fruitful or necessary in terms of ethics, I would submit. So what would I offer as an alternative to inquiring after the human difference? I propose that a much preferable way of achieving many of the same goals is to attend to the particularity and commonality of human and non-human animals. As I've just noted, there is nothing problematic about studying the particular ways in which particular human and particular non-human animals differ. Studies that attend to the particularity of what makes humans the unique kind of animals they are, and to the particularity of what makes other non-human species the unique kind of animals they are, can inform us about ourselves and our relationships with other animals in new and exciting ways. As I was writing this paper, a new study by researchers at Zurich and Exeter reported that the Australian chestnut-crowned warbler communicates meaning through different orderings of sound using a basic grammar. This is interesting in the context of previous studies showing that the abilities of songbirds to modify their songs may be related to the FOX2P gene they share with humans, which humans do not share with other primates. This discovery of a commonality between humans and these birds, but not primates, is an example of the ways our knowledge can be enhanced by escaping from the binary quest for human-non-human difference into a more complex attention to ourselves and to other animals. A final theological footnote. The bulk of this paper has not been explicitly theological, but in my view, it's my location as a Christian theologian that enables and motivates this critique. A theological view of the world can never properly be anthropocentric, because it recognizes that human beings, like every creature, are wholly dependent for their existence on God, who is the source and sustainer of all. While it sometimes forgets itself, theology is therefore properly, necessarily theocentric, centered on God. In a theological perspective, therefore, A preoccupation with the status of human being is recognizable as a failing. In Augustine's terms, a failing to see things rightly and to order one's loves properly in response. Humans overly concerned about their own status are guilty of the vice of pride, seeking their own glory in preference to the glory of God. Right vision for the Christian leads to loving God first and the creatures of God second. A concern for what it means to be human and to be in relationship with other human beings is therefore always properly seen in a theological context as a secondary activity, ordered always in relation to the primary focus on God and in relation to God's other creatures. It's not necessarily the same for an atheistic humanism. Where the supreme locus of value is the human being, there is the danger of an anthropocentrism that is uncorrected by the wider theocentric context of theology. I take this danger for humanism to be what John Gray has worked to critique in works such as Straw Dogs. I make this final theological point not to posit a binary theology-humanist difference. All too frequently, theology has fallen into the same error. But to make the case that humanists seeking to locate the project of human self-understanding in a wider animal and ecological context may find in Christian theology, Christian theologians, and even the church potential allies ready to make common cause on matters of common concern. The moral emergency I have referred to today of the way we treat other animals in intensive farming systems would, it seems to me, be an excellent place to start in this common work, as a practical outworking of the conclusion that we're better off calling off the quest for human difference. Whether this human practice of radical instrumentalization of non-human animal life is characteristically human, or characteristically inhuman, or characteristically or uncharacteristically inhumane, is no doubt a debatable question we could pursue together in relation to non-human difference. But my argument in this paper suggests we should not. Instead, I suggest, we should attend to the particularity of those other animal lives caught up in our systems. The lack of congruence between their particular desires and particular modes of flourishing and the industrial environments we force on them. And our particular human capacity to recognize our collective wrongdoing and choose to act to bring it to an end. We may not be able to agree on how to construe human difference, but perhaps we could agree that it's contrary to the best aspirations of the particular animals that we are to be so wantonly exploitative of these other particular animals.
We're going to have questions now, and I note that a number of us haven't yet, a number of you haven't yet had the chance to speak, so we encourage you to raise your hands, and we'll ask, so we can have as many questions as possible, we'll ask for short questions more than lengthy comments. So Paul's going to take it. I think we have, I'll say one, two, three, so starting.
Thank you. My, that's fighting talk. I speak as a humanist atheist and probably the ideal target for your talk. It seems to me you're conflating many things, and actually I was quite relieved towards the end of your talk when there was a bit where you said it and the bit where you took it back. You're conflating several things. One is that perhaps there are not specifically profoundly interesting differences between humans and, say, our nearest primate kin compared with other differences between, say, scorpions and bacteria. I would disagree with that. I think they are profoundly important to us, those differences. I would then disagree with things that follow from what you say. Namely, I do not think asserting human difference actually will make us more vile to each other or more vile to animals. And we can discuss that as a historical fact. But I can also register surprise that in the list of thinkers you said who asserted human differences, you didn't actually include many religious thinkers, and this may be a case of the devil's, you know, quoting the scriptures for his own purpose, but as far as I know, humans were uniquely made in the image of God, although animals obviously had sort of a bit of look in. So I think you're conflating several things, and I just want to put on record, I am deeply compassionate towards animals, but I do think there's a profound difference between us and even our nearest kin. And finally, you mentioned John Gray, and he tells you what direction your thoughts will go if you actually deny that difference. If you remember in Straw Dogs, he said, Darwin has told us that basically our lives have no more meaning than those of slime mold. And if humanity disappears from the planet, this will be no greater cause for grief, disappearance of slime mold. So you can see he is profoundly anti-humanistic, and actually I don't think he's particularly theocentric. So I think you're probably firing at the wrong targets.
Just a brief response. Thank you, Raymond. I actually don't think that you are my primary target. I wrote this paper before I arrived at this conference, and I needed to make sure that I checked through it yesterday to ensure it didn't appear that way. Fellow theologians, as I've said, are just as able to focus on the on an anthropocentric view of the world as those that have that don't have a Christian faith. So I don't target you individually or personally, but I think and I'd also concede that there are many more possible branches to any possible tradition and argument than I've indicated in what's obviously a slightly polemic and oversimplistic account presented here as challenge. But I think that our primary disagreement is on how we estimate the significance of the differences that we agree about, and how far we want to attribute significance to them in order to construct particular aspects of a worldview. That's how I'd understand our difference. And I don't doubt for a minute the sincerity of your concern for animals, and I'm delighted to hear it and celebrate that wherever I find it. But I still can't escape the vision that machine of broiler hen production is in some way justified by our focus that this is the difference that matters, and all other differences can be erased, as Derrida pointed out. I'd be very grateful, I'd be very glad to be in further conversation with you to discuss that.
Okay. So, I would like you to comment on the Christological origin of the notion of person, because it strikes me as either a further argument, but perhaps also a counter-argument to your account, because as far as I understand, so in Christology, the notion of person arises because we needed to make a difference, or theologians needed to make a difference between nature and person, and therefore not being able to define an individual by his or her characteristics. And that would argue against the project of human difference, but it would still allow for a unique difference, but which is not based on any characteristics or any trait you could point out.
Yes, thanks for that. That helps me to respond to the last part of Raymond's question as well. Of course, there are ways in which theologians have wanted to engage with the project of identifying what is particular to the human. And reference to the way that human beings are uniquely, in Genesis 1, seen to be images of God is one. And reference to the creature in which God chose to become incarnate in Jesus Christ is another. I think in both cases, we have been keen to read our self-preoccupation back into our scriptures and our theology. So it turns out that image of God is a fairly empty concept in the Bible, only fully fleshed out in Christ, who is the true image, and very rarely appearing between Genesis 1 and that Christological referent. But theologians have not been shy of finding their favorite human attribute and linking it with the image of God, as we know in the tradition, rationality, or however many other things that particular theologians thought as important and therefore characterizes our image.
Imaging, I think, is best understood as a task, in continuity with some of what Sam Barry was saying in a short paper yesterday. So we have been given the astonishing task of trying to show to the rest of creation what it would mean to behave in a godlike way. But we should interpret that as serious responsibility rather than claim to particular dignity. The language we've missed in relation to Christology is absolutely bewildering, it seems to me. So we've interpreted the incarnation as dignifying the human, whereas if anything, I think it indicates the depth of sin that was necessary and where God needed to begin a process of reconciliation and redemption. And then we've almost ignored the cosmic Christologies of Colossians and Ephesians, which show the work of Christ not as some merely single species human event, but as the reconciling of all things, tapanta, again and again through those passages. So the Christ event is not some God-human transaction, if we understand the fullness of New Testament witness. It's much bigger than that and has much wider implications for what it means to be God's creatures and participants in God's world. Now, I do want to say there is genius in the way that Christians have used image of God language and the incarnation to locate the particular value of individual human lives. And I absolutely would be fully behind every attempt to assert human dignity in contexts where that is in question. And my attention to people with learning disabilities is trying to be indicative of my passion to do that. So nothing in what I say, I hope, should be interpreted as any reduction in the value we attribute to human life. But we worship a God who is generous, and there is grace enough for humans and other animals within a Christian account of God's love towards God's creatures. And so all I'm saying is that if we make the walls a little bit lower, more we can recognize the grace of God overspilling into the lives of other creatures too.
Well, I want to thank you, David, for your paper and for an argument that I think is very important to have represented at the conference, and so something to be celebrated. My question, you framed your paper, beginning and end, with a question of rightly ordered loves in a sort of theological tone, but your alternative mode was largely about attention to difference in the mode of knowledge, coming to know and understand particular difference. Mm. And I wonder if you might relate those to how a rightly ordered love connects to knowledge and attention, and particularly in the context of a conversation between science and religion. Mm. Love is not a science word, and there are lots of ways in which attention to particular differences of those broiler hens, of those laying hens, of animals in medical experimentation, has not been, that knowledge has not been infused with love. And mm-hmm. So I just wonder if you would comment on the connection between knowledge and love.
Thank you. I think in a Christian context, and probably much more broadly, true vision is linked to love very, very importantly. And I think what you're indicating is that while I referred to the way in which our lives could be impoverished aesthetically and morally at the beginning, I didn't properly make those connections again at the end. For me, we need to be trained in seeing rightly. And traditions of thought, such as Christianity, but also many other traditions, are in one sense a training to see rightly. You can't read Matthew 25, where Jesus says, "Here I was present in those who are poor or hungry," and then see a hungry person in the same way again.
So we need to be trained in ways of seeing, and as you're indicating, that is intrinsically connected then to the way that we love, and the way that our love is drawn out by what we then apprehend in the object. And so you're right to say that there are many ways of attending to the knowledge of particularity which don't seem to manifest that love. But I will also want to hang on, I think, to the idea that, you know, the origin of biology and zoology in a university context was as natural theology, which was wondering at the magnificent works of God and attending to all the myriad ways in which God was creative. And while you don't have to be by any means a Christian to be a zoologist, I've never met a zoologist whose attention to other animals does not seem in some way motivated by an enthusiasm, an appreciation, and maybe even love for the objects of their attention. So absolutely, I think you're right that we need to connect that attentive particularity that Nancy referred to yesterday with an outflowing of love, and that might be the best hope that we have for changing moral attitudes towards other animals. Thank you.
Yes, thank you for your provocative lecture. I must recognize I'm a Franciscan monk, and so I feel quite attuned with ideas of brotherhood with creatures and closeness. But at the same time, I think that the idea of human difference is important, using the anthropological analogy you have used, that narcissism and so, because the idea of identity, personal identity is important. You ask any psychologist, and a crisis of identity could be the source of quite deep distress and so on. So it seems that humanity needs some kind of sense of identity. And I assume that you know that the dynamics of identity are built above alterity or interrelationship with other with other beings, with other humans in our case, and with animals and other creatures in more broad terms. But that's just to take responsibility about the other. So without a sense of identity, it's very difficult to engage in a relationship of responsibility with other humans and with animals. So that's to answer to your question, saying that was useless to ask for our personal identity or your narrative introducing your own identity. And then, do you think that could be a source of imbalance if we eliminate all the sense of difference between humans and animals? For example, these cases in which a lot of resources were devoted to save a couple of whales intrepid in the ice in the North Arctic Sea, instead of using these resources to help people in need. Thank you.
So, I mean, first of all, I want to repeat that I'm not saying that there are no differences between humans and other animals. I'm not saying the project of trying to identify particular differences between particular human and particular non-human modes of life can't be fruitful in many contexts. The project I'm objecting to is this univocal singular boundary, which attributes a massive significance to the particular differences that we think we can attribute between humans and all other animals, lumping them all together. That's the project I'm objecting to. Now, obviously, a sense of human identity is important, and I think it's primarily important in terms of recognizing task and vocation in a theological context. And that's where I would point to imaging as a particular task given to human beings and a particular responsibility. But it seems to me that in order to understand my role as a Christian theologian, say, I don't need to narrate my difference from every other person on the planet, as I comically tried to do at the beginning, in order to understand what I am to do.
my identity is not based on my difference. My identity is, you know, like the goldfinch, often identified by these intersecting areas of commonality. I don't need to protest my own uniqueness in order to recognize my vocation. And I don't think as humans we need to protest our own uniqueness. We need to recognize our particularity. But if we're suddenly to discover in some distant universe creatures that behave in very similar ways to the ways that we do, that doesn't change our sense of identity, it seems to me, one bit. It just makes us recognize one more element of commonality. We still have the same task. We still have the vocation. That would be no challenge whatever to a Christian understanding of God's ways with the universe. Uniqueness isn't where it's at in terms of understanding identity as a species, I want to suggest.
Thank you. Thank you for your talk, which is indeed provocative and challenging. But I would like to raise a question which could be understood mainly from an epistemological point of view and could be stated in very simple terms. My question would be why you addressed your talk to the question about human uniqueness instead of addressing it to some particular answers to this question. Because it seems to me this is the problem. And questioning the relevance of the question about human uniqueness, I'm afraid it sounds to me something epistemologically not well grounded, because human knowledge proceeds by establishing differences among something that we consider common under certain respects. Even if you consider that nowadays we have a huge amount of specific disciplines in our academic environment, this is something that we have gained in a long historical process, because, I mean, 2 centuries ago we had maybe perhaps just 3 or 4 disciplines, now we have some dozens. And this means that we, in our process of knowledge, acknowledge progressively more and more differences and specificity. And I think that in this sense, the question about human uniqueness is part and parcel of our process of knowledge. So I think that your worries could be right with respect to some specific answers or some specifically ideologically or radically connotated approaches to this question, but not to the question in itself. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right that I could have achieved some of what my aims were with a very different paper. Perhaps that would have been a paper closer to the one that Nancy offered us yesterday afternoon. So attention to, let's examine carefully this particular bonobo life and his capabilities or her capabilities, and try to see how if we can be confident of how that is to be interpreted, that might start to challenge some of the ways that we've previously narrated the human difference. So I think there's absolutely an important place for that. And you're right, I was offering a very different paper, which is in a sense a meta paper, which is trying to draw attention to what we're doing, what we have been doing together in trying to identify this human difference. I think there's a place for both, and I certainly don't think the kind of protest that I've entered is useful to repeat endlessly. I've never given a paper like this, and I may never again. But I think calling our collective attention to try and understand better or provide, you know, a more adequate rationale for the inquiry that we're engaged in, that seemed to me an important task, and you know, so that was the reason for the paper I gave. But yes, we need in many ways to be much more attentive to particular arguments. That would have been a different paper.
Hello. Well, you seem to have defended that recognizing human difference could be dangerous because it could lead to the development of hierarchies between human beings and animals, and between human beings themselves into the society. Mm-hmm. Okay, in another moment, you seem to have defended that in a life dilemma situation, you should choose a human instead of an animal, because on the same basis that we should choose a member of our family instead of other human being in the same situation. Well, my question is, don't you think that this last group identification, affective identification criteria, cannot be, in fact, more dangerous, a more dangerous factor of division in society between families, classes, races, religion, and so on, than the identifying the human nature or the human difference? And the second question is, you said that the primary aim of Christian theology is God, and only secondarily the creators. But Christ said also that after God you should love your neighborhood as yourself. So my question is, how can you, as a Christian theologian, deny the ontological priority of human beings to Christianity?
Thank you. I think the concept of neighbor that you draw attention to there is very helpful. In the parable of the Good Samaritan, what Jesus is working with is people's existing sympathies and then seeking, it seems to me, to challenge and extend them. My model of what Christian ethics is doing is similar. It's not trying to erode existing sympathies. It is seeking to build on them. And in a way, what I'm trying to do is something similar, it seems to me, to that Good Samaritan parable. What if it's not a member of a co-religionist that is lying injured by the side of the road? What if we have to think more broadly about who I find to be my neighbor? So I recognize there are dangers in appreciating that we are the kinds of creatures that are already pretty good at loving those who are most like us and most connected to us. And my children are, particular human beings that I have no difficulty in experiencing a strong love for and a desire to protect. And part of my task as a Christian, as a moral human being, is to seek to extend that, to push beyond that, to make sure that my sympathies aren't limited in that way. And so again, what I would want to say is that we need a model in a theological context, and I hope more broadly, we need a model of excess rather than a model of scarcity. It seems to me it was a very, very honorable project to try and draw a circle around the human with the aim of ensuring that no one was left out. So that was a very, very crucial moral innovation, and I'm absolutely behind that. But it seems to me the ways in which we're drawing the boundary, as I've tried to explain through Agamben, is now meaning that wall is crumbling and we're no longer protecting even the humans that we thought we were with that attempt to define the human. And so I want to defend those humans well and properly and more. And I don't think a focus on the ontological status of the human forever is going to be a good way of either protecting those humans we're called to love or the non-humans that we're called to love.
My question was actually similar to that, so you may not have more to say, but of the many things I liked very much in your talk, I really appreciate the attention to the sort of lifeboat dilemma situation you mentioned that he just referred to also. And I'm just wondering if you would want to elaborate a little bit on that. So if there's, if there's a child and a, chicken drowning, you would choose the child rather than the chicken. If there's your child and someone else is a stranger, you would choose your child. And so I don't know if Mary Mitchell, of course, talks about something like this, right? Different ways that we might determine, and species might be one, but far from the only. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more about how you would make the decision in those lifeboat situations, which we usually don't face, of course. But they do make us sort of sharpen what our criteria might be. Would species always trump? Would you always choose any human over any non-human? And if so, what might be the grounds for that? And if you can, in some magic way, work in the question of the whales and the diversion of human resources to care for those, you know, to devoted to helping animals rather than, which I think I have to say, with all due respect, is a very false dilemma, because we were not really, the resources that went to that weren't really going to go to, you know, vaccinate children in sub-Saharan Africa who might otherwise die of a contagious disease or whatever way. And I think that's why perhaps we like the lifeboat dilemmas, because they make it a very direct one or the other. And most of the times you say, well, you could have spent that on helping humans instead of animals. Most of the time, no, you really weren't going to help humans with that. But anyway, that's, I don't know if you have anything more you want to say about that.
To be honest, Anna, I'd really prefer not to. You noted that that section of my paper was sort of in a clarificatory mode. It's the kind of thing that I feel forced to say to avoid being badly misunderstood. But what I worry is that we, because of our delight in focusing on that kind of extreme case, we use that extreme case to distract ourselves from the much more common context in which human and non-human lives are not at stake. It seems to me you only need to extend us. You don't need to extend sympathy to the broiler hen that I held very far. It doesn't need to be a human level of concern before you recognize that this practice is entirely unjustified. You know, if we stopped using 70% of our productive agricultural land to raise domesticated animals, we would feed human beings a whole lot better, and obviously have very beneficial implications for climate change. So I would really prefer that as ethicists we kind of shift our attention to the really important pressing questions. The distribution of resources to save the whales and vaccination might be one that might press something like that lifeboat scenario, but again, as you say, it's more complex than that in the real world. My brother worked for a long time as financial director of Oxfam, and he was very concerned, like many people in that area, about the budgets for various non-human animal charities in comparison to the human ones. But again, we don't very often choose to save the human rather than the donkey in a particular development context. So again, I would want us to be generous wherever we can. I think we could have an interesting further conversation about those lifeboat dilemmas, but I'd much prefer to drag our attention back to the pressing pressing and much morally simpler questions that we are systematically avoiding.
Yes, well, when I first listened to your talk, at the first 15 minutes, I thought it was pretty accusatory, and it seemed to suggest that ignorance would be better than knowledge. That is, and I said, no, surely you can't mean this. And of course, you gradually backed off towards the latter part of your talk, I was glad to see. But it's almost as if you were accusing atomic physicists as having as their primary long-term goal the building of a bomb. And of course, that isn't true. But in the case of my own life, I've spent a lot of time trying to define human nature, okay? Now, what's my motive for doing this? It's not to gloat. You know, I'm not sitting up in my high horse saying, what a great people we are, and et cetera, et cetera. Not at all. In fact, I'm extremely concerned because there's a large-scale change occurring on the planet. We're the cause. It's not by accident that geologists have renamed our era the Anthropocene, because they expect that in the geological record in the future there will be a record, a tangible effect of human presence. So there is a large-scale global thing happening. It's not happening to chickens or slime molds or whatever, although before we're finished, we may have slime molds more than we want. But the point is, I think it's important to understand what's going on quite independently of a species narcissism. And I fully agree, we are prone to individual and species narcissism on a grand scale. You just have to go back to the Bible to see where that starts. And well, it didn't start there. Undoubtedly, every tribe defines anyone they don't know as subhuman. I mean, it's a natural thing. Mm. So, in a way, we're thinking our way out of our narcissism, and knowledge is the only way I know to get out of there. Ignorance will only bring us back to it. Just my comment.
I really appreciate that, Merlin. I think that would provide ground for a great deal of additional conversation. The kind of human exceptionalism that I would have no trouble with at all is the kind of dire impact that human activity is currently having on the planet in a way that is not the case for any other creature, as you say. And so it seems to me that the kind of study that might attend to what are the particular dynamics of what makes human life in its current state so strongly dysfunctional that we seem unable to respond even to an existential species challenge, let alone to recognize the implications for other species, that would be a wholly honorable way of attending to what it means to be particular and human. But I don't know if you'd agree, but it seems to me most of the time when we try to specify human difference, we're not doing it in that way. We're not identifying how low we have sunk. We're climbing a ladder, trying to identify a more and more lonely place that we can find for ourselves at the top of a particular peak. And that's my concern with the project. But absolutely, the project you describe of trying to understand ourselves in order to address a very particular problem is something that is entirely worthy and very strongly needed.
Thank you for a very enriching talk. It's a couple things. Okay, I'll just ask one question. I wanted to sort of follow up on your reference to Derrida, and in particular, you picked up on his point about how talking about the animal rather than recognizing animals plural is a mistake. And he calls that a bêtise, sort of playing on the idea that's stupidity in French, but also playing on the word bête, which is beast. But he then talks about a sort of a twin bêtise, which is to deny that there's a fundamental rupture between humans and all other animals. And I wonder if there's a danger in what you're saying of sort of in trying to avoid the one bêtise sort of swing toward the other, that, I mean, you were insisting that, there are particular differences between particular, humans and other particular species and all of the rest, but it seems like there's a danger then of denying that there is also this fundamental rupture, which Derrida wants to say isn't a clean line. It's a very complicated and mixed rupture, but that to deny that rupture is also a mistake or a problem.
Yes, in the sense that, yes, you're right, Derrida is not characteristically trying to advance one other sort of simplistic and non-deconstructible position. And so the article we're discussing is astonishingly playful and multi-layered and complex. If I were part of the conversation that was that's kind of reported in relation to Derrida and interlocutors, I would want to ask him what he really meant by that particular rupture. I've listed all these other thinkers that have identified all these other characteristics, but it seems to me that in relation to every other animal, we could look at neighboring animals and identify the rupture that characterizes this species. It returns to what is the rationale for our particular attention to the particular ways that we differ from particular other species, and especially our nearest relatives, and the huge weight morally, intellectually that we build that carries for us.
And it seems to me if we've been wrong pretty much every time we've tried to do that through our intellectual history, then we ought to be really careful about thinking, well, I guess Derrida's image is right. If there is some rupture, then trying to build anything on it would be a mistake, right? Because it's going to fall. It seems to me we need to be attending to a particular difference, to the particular creatures that we are, the particular role that we have, but looking down into the void that we see, it seems to me, as I've said, unfruitful.
If I've missed you, and I'm sure I've missed several, please just line up, maybe get a cup of tea for David, and then line up and ask him yourself. Thank you very much. We have some announcements.